All right, good morning. Now that we're all technically ready, I would like to warmly welcome you to this morning's meeting, especially our distinguished panel, which has traveled from quite far and woken up quite early to be here with us. I'm really honored, actually, that we have such a great panel offering very different perspectives from a government point of view, two different governments, actually, from the United States and from Indonesia, an academic point of view, media point of view, NGO point of view, and corporate point of view. And all of these insights are very important in our discussions of this morning's topic, free speech in a hyper-connected world. How do we deal with this? This discussion fits in a broader discussion that we've been having in the European Parliament for the past years, actually, where we try to look at the revolutionary impact of technological developments, not only at our own societies and the people that live in the European Union, but also how it impacts our foreign and security policy. In fact, I'm leading the efforts now to write the first ever EU strategy to try to mainstream and have a clear policy around how the EU should protect digital freedoms in its foreign and security policies. And these discussions are not clear-cut. We are really trying to understand what is relevant policy, how to deal with the revolutionary changes that technological developments bring, on the one hand, as they offer opportunities for enabling fundamental human rights such as free expression, press freedom, access to information, freedom of assembly, but also, for example, the documentation and sharing of human rights violations. On the other hand, we have to be realistic about the threats that technologies can also bring. When we look at human rights, there's increased mass surveillance, mass censorship, and other kinds of repression, also with the help of technologies, sadly, often exported from the EU and the United States, democracies and self-proclaimed free societies. And the new reality that these new technologies create, one of hyper-connectivity, challenges traditional borders of nation states, traditional jurisdictions as we know them. And this is precisely what we're going to talk about today. And we're going to zoom in on the issue of free expression this morning. As I mentioned, and I'll highlight again, we have a very distinguished panel. I've asked them to stick to approximately 5 to 10 minutes for their introductions. And then we're looking forward to interactive debate with you, not only here in the room, but via live stream. We can be followed online as well, and we have a hashtag on Twitter so that people can participate remotely. So please look at the Twitter feed as well if you're interested in what people outside of this room are thinking, and I will be looking at my laptop only for that reason. So don't feel like I'm not interested in what's going on here, but really trying to open this discussion up as widely as we can. So without further ado, let me briefly introduce the panel and then we can get started. His Excellency Ambassador William Kennard of the United States, the Ambassador of the United States to the EU, has recorded a video. He was unable to be here, but we'll look at his intervention. And then we're very happy that His Excellency Ambassador Ugro Senyo from Indonesia is here with us this morning to participate. Then we'll hear from Bill Ekkiksen, who is the head of free expression policy and PR in Europe, the Middle East, and Africa for Google, which owns YouTube and which has made some decisions recently around free expression that we'd love to hear more about. Then we have Professor Mireille Hildebrand from the Netherlands, who focuses on smart environments, data protection, but also the rule of law in an online environment. She does this at the Radboud University in Nijmegen in the Netherlands. To my left, Gustav Bessems, a journalist at the Dutch newspaper Volkskrant, has specialized in freedom of expression, written a long essay about it, and also has covered immigration and integration issues in the Netherlands extensively in the past. And he is now editing Vonk, which is a
good morning
edition in Volkskrant newspaper. And last but not least, Samir Padania, who is now working with the media program of the Open Society Foundation in London, but has extensive experience in working on video and human rights, among others, for the organization called Witness. And we look forward to hearing from him as well. So let's now start with the video of Ambassador Kennard. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Bill Kennard, U.S. Ambassador to the European Union. The issue of free speech in our hyper-connected world is of great importance to the United States. I'm therefore glad to have the opportunity to be able to speak with you via this video message. This discussion in the European Parliament could not have come at a more relevant time, and I would like to commend Marietje for organizing it. You know, since the recent unrest in Pakistan, Egypt, and other parts of the Middle East, we have also been very busy explaining why the U.S. so vigorously defends freedom of expression. As Americans, we have absolutely no doubt about why we must defend our fundamental freedoms of expression, freedom of religion and assembly. They are the constitutional bedrock on which many of our other rights rest. In fact, our country was founded by people who came to North America seeking freedom to express their own religion. These freedoms allow us to practice our religion as we see fit, even when our beliefs may be offensive to others. They allow us to congregate en masse in a hall, to demonstrate peacefully in the streets, or publish scientific findings that challenge established beliefs. We also see a connection between our freedom of expression and the culture of innovation and entrepreneurship. We believe that free expression is one of the drivers of prosperity. It's a core American belief that there is a connection between our freedom to think and express our thoughts and our creativity, innovation, and ability to organize our companies and societies in ways that make us more productive, more efficient, and more prosperous. Freedom of expression has allowed us to develop an internet that is the freest, most open, and most flexible form of communication in human history. So you may say, fine, but what happens when one person's free expression insults another person's religion? Let me be very clear about this. Religions don't have human rights. Individual humans do. Religions can't be defamed. Their adherents can be insulted, but when they are, it is the right to condemn the speech, but wrong to resort to violence against the speaker. So, while we condemn hateful speech and deplore speech that deliberately denigrates believers of any religion, we do not ban it. We don't believe that it is an appropriate role for government to play. As a result of our strong protections of speech, for example, our courts have upheld the rights of neo-Nazis, Holocaust deniers, white supremacists, anti-gay sects, to march in public, to distribute literature, to even attempt to convince others of the rightness of their cause. We've even allowed these types of people to protest at military funerals. As President Obama said to the UN General Assembly recently, most Americans are Christian, and yet we do not ban blasphemy against our most sacred Christian beliefs. All of this is not because we approve of hateful speech in any way, but because we strongly believe that such hatred withers in the face of public scrutiny, and that censorship will only force hateful ideology to find a new venue in which to manifest itself. Our commitment to freedom of expression doesn't mean that we sit idly by in the face of intolerance and hate either. The United States cares deeply about combating discrimination and abuses that are based on religious intolerance. One of the mechanisms that we have in our government are hundreds of people at the Department of Justice whose job it is every day to sue organizations, including government organizations, who violate anti-discrimination laws. There have also been special task forces created to address challenges faced by particular groups, for instance, to combat discrimination against Arab and Muslim Americans. Internationally, we are very committed to this work. The United States joined a resolution led by the Organization of Islamic Cooperation at the Human Rights Council in 2011 that was aimed at combating religious intolerance. We remain committed to working with partners to help tackle problems like hate crimes, discrimination, violence that is based on religious intolerance. Ladies and gentlemen, there will always be some people who say offensive things. And then there will always be a temptation to make laws that limit that kind of speech. However, we all know that such laws don't solve the problem. Bans on speech don't reduce hatred. They invariably end up being used by the powerful to go after members of political or religious minority groups, or anyone who criticizes those in power. We know this to be the case. Now, everyone in this room knows that there are big dividends from adhering to our universal rights. So it is more important than ever for the United States and the European Union to work together and do our utmost to ensure that freedom of expression is protected. There are many things that we can do together, continuing to educate, foster interfaith discussions. We can urge political, religious, and societal leaders to speak out and condemn offensive expression. We can work together to create mechanisms to identify and address areas of tension between communities. We can train government officials on outreach strategies and encourage leaders to discuss the causes of discrimination and potential solutions within their communities. But most importantly, our message must be heard loud and clear that violence is never, ever an acceptable response to speech. So again, thank you very much for inviting me to address this group today, and I apologize that I could not be with you in person. Thank you.
I would like to thank Ambassador Canard for his contribution, in which he firmly protects the freedom of expression and offers a debate instead of new laws as the best solution for potential differences among people. Now, Ambassador Groseno, would you like to share your thoughts on how Indonesian government thinks about freedom of expression?
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank you for inviting me today in this very important debate. I think this is timely to have a discussions on this issue in the European Parliament, and especially with regard to what just happened recently. Let me start with quotations from the press release of Amnesty International a couple of months back. In a press release entitled "Freedom of Speech Carries Responsibilities for All," Amnesty stated that the right to freedom of opinion and expression should be one of the cornerstones of any society. However, the right to freedom of expression is not absolute. It carries responsibility and it may be subject to restrictions. And Amnesty further stated that under international standards, such hate speech should be prohibited by law. I think we all are aware that under the current international law, especially the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, religious hatred is stipulated against. And we have also the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. Indonesia ratified both of these conventions already in 2005 and in 1993. And I think in Western liberal democracies, hate speech and blasphemy laws, they do exist. Austria, Belgium, Denmark, France, many other countries in the European Union. Not only they do exist, but they are also enforced. And I think this is what makes it a bit different with the U.S. Having been a student in the U.S., I'm studying law and also work in a law firm in the U.S., I think what Ambassador Canard mentioned was something that is probably typically American. You have the First Amendment and you have all these court cases brought and strengthened the First Amendment. And that is probably why you don't have a blasphemy law in the United States. I think it is also rather specific in the U.S. if we look also at the Second Amendment, the right to keep and bear arms. It is a constitutional right to have a assault rifle in the U.S., not in Europe or in any part of the world. So this is something that's particular for the United States. And I think for us, for Indonesians, we also have a law that strikes the balance between freedom of expression and responsibilities. I mean, Indonesia is a country of 214 million people. We have 300 different ethnics. We have 700 living languages, five major religions and beliefs. And that means we need to keep the balance in the social fabrics very, very, in a very delicate way. Now, we also try to develop a strong moderate, to empower the moderate. If you look at the reactions of the Indonesians vis-a-vis the video, the film, we saw that we have a couple of hundred people demonstrating in the streets of Indonesia. But 1 week after that, we have 3 million people demonstrating against outsource of labor. So we have a couple of hundred people demonstration against the film, but we have 3 million people having demonstration on labor laws, on the outsourcings of foreign companies, and this actually shows where are the priorities of people in Indonesia. And also at the same time, we had a new governor in Jakarta, of which the vice governor was not a Muslim. It was actually analyzed quite deep in the Economist, basically showing that the maturity of democracy in Indonesia is such that maybe other countries could have a look as a comparative model. So this would be one element that is very strong, how should I say, put in the debate of freedom of speech in the hyper-connected world. Now, specifically on the problem of hyperconnections, the flow of information is hyperconnected, but not the law. I'll give you an example of our problems that we have a couple of years ago. We have a case of corruptions. We have someone who stole government money, $750 million. The person was convicted for life imprisonment. And the money was taken by his sister, and it was taken to the Netherlands. And we asked for help to return the money, but we were refused. This is a couple of years ago. I don't know what is the case today. But it shows that this is not a typical problem only in the internet. It's a problem in the financial transactions also. You have a very fast movement of information. You have a very fast movement of money. But the laws are not necessarily the same or compatible. And probably this happens in other areas, but I don't know what would be the other examples. Now, coming to the questions, I think what role should companies and governments play? I would say that we should play by the book. What I mean by the book is by the international standards that we adhere to, by international convention that we ratify. But in certain extent whereby we cannot or we do not have that international standard yet, then maybe it's something that we could consider having a framework at international level. That's probably the first one. The second one, digital freedom, I think, as I refer to what Amnesty is saying, also requires what we call the digital responsibilities, probably. But what is the form of responsibility? How far it is? Is it based on the national law or regional law? It is something that can be discussed further. The third one and the last one is that I believe this is a very important issue, but to have this link to trade barriers through other measures relating to international trade, that will open up into another host of different issues, which may or may not be positive in terms of how we see this particular issue addressed. I mean, if we wanted to address the hyperconnections world and the context of the free speech in which we enjoy them, but if we then relate that into protectionism, trade barriers, then you invite host of problems with relating to trade protectionisms and invite all kind of different disputes coming in the WTO, in which I don't think it's a good way to start in the global slum of economic development. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. So balancing free speech with responsibilities, but in what form? I think nobody has the golden solution, but perhaps we'll speak about it further. And I appreciate your sharing the thoughts on behalf of your country, which of course is quite different from the European Union. So it's very helpful to have a different perspective. I would now like to turn to Bill to share the perspective from within a company that has a lot to do with this hyper-connected world, is perhaps one of its main facilitators, Google.
Okay, now that everyone hears me, thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to come speak here in the European Parliament, because I do think this is a critical time for the internet, and that we are seeing nothing less than really a war against the free and open web. Let's just look at the statistics. According to the Open Net Initiative, there are 44 countries today that censor, filter, or block the web, and that's up from 4 a decade ago. And that's pretty alarming. Often we're seeing this from not just the usual suspects, so to speak, but from also democratically elected governments. I mean, just recently our country president in Brazil was arrested for a case of what is free speech. And often the restrictions are put on for reasons that are the best of intentions. For example, protecting children, something that we all want to do, but that can be, in the end, used to fundamentally shut down an open internet. Now, at Google, we do feel we're on the front lines of this battle, because we operate in about 150 countries around the world, and at any one time, our services are blocked or filtered or banned in about more than 30 of them. It can be maps, because governments don't like the way we put boundaries. It's often YouTube, as we found out in recent weeks. It can be Blogger, too. We've talked a lot here about the YouTube video mocking Islam, which we condemn as well, as, but which we believe is a free part of free speech and was not inciting to hate and so forth. And yet every day I come into the office and I see a list of a new country that has either banned YouTube in response or called for us to take down the video. This is for Google. This freedom of speech that is threatened is a human right. I mean, the company was set up to democratize access to information, to make it, and the internet offers that tremendous possibility, the liberating possibility of giving everyone, anywhere, the access to information. I mean, for example, we've digitized books in the University of Ghent, not far from here, books that no one had seen for tens of years, or that one person would go up into the dusty shelves to go get. And now anyone in Australia, in Azerbaijan, in America, can have access to that. And that is revolutionary in a positive way. So we believe that free speech and the access to information is a human right. But we also believe that this is an issue that will drive development and social and economic progress, that freedom on the net is something that will, in the end, lead to progress around the world. And to prove that, or to at least get the conversation started, we took the Freedom House ratings of internet freedom, press and internet freedom, and we measured them against the sort of economic and social success that were measured by the United Nations. Innovation, level of education, and so forth. And what we found was very surprising. I mean, we did see that Northern Europe and the United States, the freedom leaders, scored the highest in educational achievement, and that countries such as Iran and Zimbabwe and other repressive regimes scored the lowest. It didn't really matter what size you were. Tiny Estonia was ranked first in many of these comparisons on patents per capita filed and so forth, and innovation, other factors of innovation. And we did see that the Asian tigers, which didn't score very well on the Freedom Index, also in many ways, surprisingly, didn't score that well on education and social achievement, according to the United Nations. Now, I mean, this isn't definitive, but it is something that we would like to see talked about and discussed more, the link between freedom and economic and social development. So I think we're standing at a crossroads. In the past decade, the internet now reaches 2 billion people who have access to it, and it's opened up the possibility for all of them to express themselves and reach a global audience. Before joining Google, I was a journalist, and I remember that it was only me who could type out my articles and take the subway to get them published through teletype. Now I could do it. We can all speak to each other right from here, right from the MacBook that you're using, Marietje. So the dangers, I think, will come to a head. We're worried in the ITU, International Telecommunications Union, in December, when there will be, we fear, a group of governments that would want to extend government control over the internet. At the same time, we do recognize that there's the freedom of expression doesn't mean that there's no limit to what can be said. We do put in a global ban against child pornography, which is illegal in virtually every country. We remove spam and results that, you know, could hurt users. But whenever we're requested to take down information or hand over information on users, we try to push back as much as possible, to limit the requests, make sure they're done by court order and in writing. And we report them on what we call a transparency report. If you Google transparency report, you will see how we report how we take down content, in what how many requests we get in each country to take down content or hand over information on users, and how many that we have complied with. And we update this every 6 months. Finally, we talked here about corporate responsibility. We believe that corporations have the need to gather together, not to appease governments, not to rush to the bottom, to the lowest common denominator for free speech. And we worked with Microsoft and Yahoo, with NGOs, and others, academics, to set up something, a group called the Global Network Initiative. And I know that they've been visiting Europe, the representatives. The idea is really that we have an independent assessment of how we perform on human rights, and that we, I know also that, for example, in the case of the Islam video, that we heard from NGOs within the Global Network Initiative. It was a forum for expression, many of whom criticized our decisions. So the big problem we face with this movement towards corporate responsibility on internet freedom is that it should be the Global Network Initiative, but until now, unfortunately, it's really been more of the American Network Initiative, because most of the main members are American. And what we really would like to see are European companies join with us to make sure that it truly, this movement, the Global Network Initiative, the global movement to protect free expression online, becomes truly global. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bill, I'm counting. There should be limits to free speech, but now the question, and I'm sure this will be up for debate, is who decides? You know, is it a judge? Is it a company? Is it NGOs? Is it multi-stakeholders? Who passes these decisions? So perhaps an academic perspective, a legal perspective, can shed a different light on this. Professor Mireille Hildebrand, we have someone helping you with your presentation. And maybe we can turn off the lights as well.
Okay. Thank you very much for this invitation. Of course, academics don't have any answers. They have only more questions. I'm very curious about how it goes with the presentation, because I've put some animation in it, but let's see what happens. first you have to locate it. You need a search engine for that, I think, because there's quite a lot of files on the... If you sort them by date and you take the one from 8:51 this morning, which will come up. Yes, I think you have it. Yes, exactly. Very good. Is there for me a way to remote control this?
I don't think so.
Okay, so then I'll be giving you a lot of signs.
Yeah.
Like, so you see my hand going up all the time. I want to to talk briefly about free speech, the rule of law, the rule of law in the internet and internet freedom, and start with free speech, freedom of speech. And I think the first thing, okay, there is a fundamental right of free speech. There is the First Amendment of the United States Constitution. We have Article 10, European Convention of Human Rights. But the question is, what does it mean? How is it interpreted? It's obvious that this is not a worldwide similar interpretation. And to push the debate a little bit, I want to make a difference between free speech fundamentalism, and I tend to put the United States on that angle. And there's a very interesting book has been published by legal philosopher Jeremy Waldron under the title The Harm of Free Hate Speech. And Jeremy Waldron makes a difference between offensive speech, which falls under free speech. A democracy is served by antagonistic debate, even offensive debate if necessary. But then he makes a difference with hate speech, which he defines as speech that violates human dignity. So that is that constitutes a violation, that constitutes damage to human dignity. I like the way he phrases it. He says it doesn't cause that, but it constitutes that. It is an exclusionary way of thinking about people. Now, of course, Jeremy Waldron is talking about one particular jurisdiction. He's having a debate within the United States about the meaning of the First Amendment. But maybe we can learn something about the fact that even within the United States, there are differences of opinion. And that it certainly cannot be the case that the mainstream opinion of what is free speech in the United States should be enforced all over the world. Now, of course, it's obvious that, for instance, in Europe, we have prohibitions and, in some cases, criminalizations of hate speech, libel, slander, blasphemous, incitement to violence. There are different types of defenses. For instance, the defense that whatever you said was true. There is the artistic exception. I don't know whether the word artistic would apply to the film that that was the immediate cause of this meeting, but these are all exceptions. And perhaps it's interesting to know that the first case about jurisdiction on the internet was a case against Yahoo in France, which was actually exactly on this topic, because in the United States, denial of the Holocaust and selling Nazi stuff is not prohibited, falls under the First Amendment. And in France, it was. It was also criminalized. And the big question was, who's going to win out here? At that point, the idea was that if you filter the internet in the United States, if you want to filter the internet in France, you have to also filter it in the United States. And actually, the case was decided when somebody developed a software tool. This is the importance of the technological infrastructure that made it possible to filter content specifically for France. And that is when the French court decided, okay, we are not living under the First Amendment in the United States. So it ordered Yahoo to block sites from for France IP addresses. Okay, now this is of course a form of censure. And the question is, who is doing the censure? This question has already been raised. Is it a particular government? Is it some sort of world government? We don't have that, so the answer there is no. Or is it large companies or small companies? The more interesting question at this moment, I find, is why is this censure happening? Is it to protect a particular government against dissensus? Is it to protect corporate interests? Or is it to protect different interpretations of human dignity? Let's go to the rule of law. Something that many people forget is that the rule of law, historically, but also very practically, depends on the monopoly of violence. Because the rule of law basically means that you have an internal division of sovereignty, which means that the courts, in the end, decide about the meaning of the law, even if that is against the legislator. The rule of law basically means that after the legislator has spoken, it's not up to the legislator to decide what exactly that means. Now, if you do not have a monopoly of violence, like we have in a world of different sovereign states, then in that sense, we do not have a rule of law. So we have to think of something else. This raises, obviously, the question of digital human rights protection, national jurisdiction over the internet, and questions of internet governments. Basically, it becomes very difficult to talk about governance. You have to talk about governance. And this brings in the issue of so-called walled gardens, both in the sense that authoritarian regimes close off their jurisdiction, or commercial platforms that require authentication and have some sort of access control. So now let's move from here to internet freedom. And I think when people talk about internet freedom, they mix all sorts of different ideas. There are, of course, some people that think that internet freedom means that the internet is for free, in the sense of gratis. I think a lot has been said about it. This is, of course, obviously not true, no free lunch theorem. There are business models in background which afford all the wonderful tools of the internet. And I think that this is not obvious to everybody. It creates a lot of confusion. When I was listening to the statement made by Google now, I thought that there are still a lot of people who think that the internet is a utopian construction and is going to bring only good things. I think that the internet is a pharmacon. A pharmacon is a medicine, if you use it in one way. But if you use it in another way, it's a poison. So the question is not, is internet inherently good? The question is, how are we going to design it or redesign it? And who's going to decide what is good? Now, let's compare freedom of the internet, open internet, and the related idea of dual and single use of technologies. Freedom of internet can mean free access, a right, a human right to free access, unrestricted access, and net neutrality. That is something else than saying that it means unrestricted freedom of exchange of information. You could say that that inherently denies that there are cultural differences between the understanding of things like hate speech. The term open internet, again, means something else. It's more about the global and borderless nature of the internet, and it relates to this issue of walled gardens. Maybe the most interesting is to look at all these issues from the perspective of the technological infrastructure itself. Because imagine if you would say, okay, under certain circumstances, it is up to a democratic constituency to decide how they want to interpret the human right of free expression. And that means that at some point they will censure, like censure is already happening all the time, both by technical companies and governments. But the implementation of this censure on the internet has very different implications from the implementation of those restrictions outside the internet, because you have to do some form of blocking, monitoring, filtering, and in extreme situation, a shutdown. And these methods, quite irrespective of whether you appreciate the goal or not, have far-reaching consequences. So even somebody who might be in favor of protecting human dignity and therefore restricting freedom of speech might still be against doing that in the internet because of all the different implication it has. I saw in the declaration that was presented, on the one hand, under number 24, the idea of a minimum regulation of the internet, and on the other hand, human rights protection online. And there is, of course, a contradiction between the two. Either you want to regulate the internet in such a way that you put, for instance, free speech on number one, or you say, no, let this happen by itself. To that last idea, which seems to accord with the idea of minimum regulation, I would say that we cannot assume that without regulation, the internet will continue to favor open access, anonymous communication, free exchange of information. If we do not regulate it, it may happen or it may not happen, but these are decisions that we have to take. So the different questions that are at stake here is the content. What regulation should we wish for? And that means, do we allow different interpretations of fundamental rights, or do we want one particular interpretation, for instance, of the United States, to have enforcement over the entire global internet? That connects, of course, to the question, whose regulation? Regulation in a democracy is by a democratic constituency. It is not there on the world. So it may be interesting to make a difference between constituency, national jurisdictions that have a democratic legitimation and that don't, and then, of course, the idea of how to enforce this, the fact that there is no monopoly of violence, and in that sense, there is no rule of law. I think that's it.
Okay. That's not it. Yes. Thank you so much, and thanks for bearing with us with some technical limitations, but I think a very good basis for our debate later as well, you know, what kind of regulations do we need, whose regulations are they, and what kind of methods would work without sort of undermining the open internet itself, key questions really, and also key concepts around free speech in a hyper-connected world. I would now like to ask Gustav Bessems to share his thoughts on this issue.
Good morning, and thank you. I'm grateful for the opportunity to be here with you this morning. Thank you, Marietje, for the invitation. It's particularly gratifying to be holding this discussion on a topic very close to my heart here in the building of the European Parliament, because it is this institution, this Parliament, that I felt, as a European, let me down recently. And that had everything to do with today's topic, free speech in a hyper-connected world and how leaders should respond. I felt let down by the president of this Parliament, Martin Schulz. He stood before the cameras and condemned in the strongest possible terms a film called, it's been mentioned before here, Innocence of Muslims, an amateuristic video directed against the Islamic prophet Muhammad that has led to anger in a number of Muslim-majority countries. Now, why did I feel so let down? Do I think that The Innocence of Muslims is a wonderful movie, or that Mr. Schulz has some kind of obligation to like this video? No, of course not. But let me mention that at that point in time, in response to the video, the American ambassador to Libya and some of his staff had been slaughtered in Benghazi. Dozens of people had been killed in protests. First of all, Mr. Schulz's response to that violence, I think he said something like, violence is never the solution, was preposterously modest to the way he denounced the film that he just went on and on about. Second, not only did he distance himself from the content of the film, he also distanced himself from the distribution of the film. And later he clarified that he had had no intention to hint towards censorship, but his words could have been understood in that way, especially since he was speaking to a global audience, also to people for whom it is normal that governments censor films. Third, he was standing to a representative of Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is a country where, for instance, journalist Hamza Kashgari was detained in February of this year for a few mildly critical poetic tweets about the Prophet. How could the chair of this parliament not even mention the words freedom of speech in that company? But there's something even more fundamental. Mr. Schulz made his statement in the face of threats and violence. Given that, when asked about the content of the film, in my eyes, only one answer would have been appropriate. And that is, in this stage, my opinion about the content of that film is irrelevant. First, the violence must end. I guess the most crucial question that has been put on the agenda for this morning is how to ensure that our rights and freedoms online, either as individuals or as part of an internet public, are best protected and served. Preserved. And there are lots of debates to be had related to that question, legal ones. I believe that many countries have laws that restrict free speech far too much. Laws against blasphemy, they've been mentioned. Against religious insult, for instance, I think they should be abolished. Or laws that make it possible to ban genocide denial. I also think those should be abolished. In Austria, a politician was convicted for defaming Muhammad. In the Netherlands, a group was convicted for cartoons that trivialized the Holocaust. And all this is child's play when we look beyond the boundaries of Europe, for instance, to Pakistan, where the blasphemy law is used commonly to persecute religious minorities, such as Christians. There are debates to be had on corporate policies. What do you do when you're YouTube and the White House asks you to review a video for possible removal? Now, I know that we can all complain to YouTube about videos, but sometimes, somehow, I feel that the impact might be different if your last name is Obama. Or another topic, to what extent is it acceptable that a totalitarian and ultra-nationalist regime in Beijing censors Google? Some say we need more legal or corporate restrictions in an immigration country, in a multicultural society, because there are so many differences. And some say this is also needed in a globalized, interconnected world, because we want peace and quiet, a harmonious civilization where we don't hurt each other's feelings, with the risk of provoking fierce reactions. But I believe the opposite is true. I think restrictions are an excuse not to have an open conversation about who we are, what we share, how we differ, what differences we find acceptable, and how we deal with these differences. I think this conversation is key in a multicultural, hyper-connected world, and yes, sometimes this conversation is rude and it will hurt your feelings. We can ask each other to take feelings into account, we can try and convince each other, but we should not sue each other into obedience, let alone use intimidation, threats, and violence to get our way. Because that's the other risk, the most dangerous one, that we lose ourselves in a competition of hurt, in the international indignation championships, where being offended becomes a form of power play. Whoever acts the most offended determines the limits of our free speech. And the ultimate weapon in that competition is saying, you've hurt my feelings so badly, you are simply forcing me to cut off your head. And the worst response to that is, They want to cut off our heads, so boy, we must have really hurt their feelings. I've seen up close the effects of intimidation and violence in response to art and opinions. I know publicists, activists, and politicians who need 24/7 protection. Artists that have been beaten up in the streets or have given up working altogether. Journalists and cartoonists that have been attacked. And I was there that cold morning in November of 2004 when the Dutch filmmaker Theo van Gogh was slaughtered in the streets of Amsterdam. I could still make out the knife sticking out from his chest. And I remember what overwhelmed me the most. It was his innocence. Theo van Gogh had been someone who had said the most horrible things about religious and ethnic groups and about celebrities. But all that was ridiculously futile, seeing the violence that he was the victim of. You see, some say that words can hurt as much as a knife. However, when you offer these people the choice between saying something very harsh about something they believe in or actually cutting off one of their limbs, it's generally pretty predictable which choice they will make. We might differ on the extent to which legal and corporate rules should rein in our expressions, and we can discuss that. But let the biggest divide be the one between those of us that are willing to reason and those that use intimidation and force. This is the most important step to ensure our rights and freedoms. Let us agree that those who bully, threaten, or use violence lose every right to even be part of this conversation. And let us agree that we exclude them until they stop. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Strong words, heated discussions we've had also in this parliament about what President Schulz said, certainly not in the name of all members of this parliament, I can assure you. But really, you know, is there a race to the bottom? Is violence in response to speech dragging us down a path that we should prevent? I think another fascinating and important angle to our discussion, which we will almost get to, but not before Samir Padania has an opportunity to share his thoughts. Thank you.
Thanks, Marietje, for inviting me to be part of this panel. Also a panel on which I didn't expect Jacques Derrida to come up so quickly. So the pharmacon. So thank you for that. I want to make clear that today, although I am now working for the Open Society Foundations, I'm speaking primarily about the experience that I had working over the previous 5 years at the intersection of human rights and sort of technology policy, working for both in the human rights sector with an organization called Witness in New York, and also working with some of the companies that, including Google, to try and think about human rights standards in technology. All of this work cuts across very diverse groups from diverse sectors. I'm conscious that a lot of the discussion so far is about principles, is about the rule of law, is about how things are applied on, if you like, on a sort of policy level. And the thing is that these decisions, these policies, affect wide varieties of stakeholders, wide varieties of sectors, from media companies and journalists to civil society, to individual citizens, to the way that people share their own content on social networks and so on. So I wanted to try and root what I'm going to say in thinking about how coming from a sort of civil society perspective, a sort of broader outside perspective that isn't always included in those policy discussions, and also has a lot of trouble in getting to participate in those discussions and influencing them. Everyone, all of us, we're struggling how to reconcile these issues, these policy issues, human rights law, international law, and so on, how these play out in the domain of the internet, at the same time as using technologies that are shifting continually, pushing forward, and sort of evolving very, very rapidly. So new issues and new challenges confront us before we've solved or pretended to solve the last set that came up last week or a month ago or whatever. And what's been striking to me over the past 4 or 5 years is how, when talking to people working in this domain, whether it's technologists, how little time and how little opportunity they have to reflect on ethical matters. When you're talking to policymakers, how little they're able to draw intersections between, for example, you know, you mentioned trade, for example, Ambassador. So how to relate trade with copyright policy, or how to relate, you know, the intersectionality of these policy domains that are, that were historically very, very separate. Or with NGO colleagues or foundations or so on, who want to be more involved and have certain positions and a wealth of experience on understanding issues of freedom of speech as they relate, for example, to a previous sphere of communication in the media, in journalism and so on, but have you're scrambling, in a sense, to try and understand how to participate and how to influence the debates that we have of this kind, you know, in a world where billions are sharing information and so on. So to me, that sort of feels like it's important to say, because there is a capacity gap in every single area. There is no area of this debate where there aren't people who are trying to understand what is going on, and who, there's nobody who has an overall picture of this. So that leads really to a sort of core principle, if you like, for me, which is that collaboration is the only way out of this. As you know, you've mentioned public debate. I think public debate is core to this, open public debate. But again, as part of that, transparency needs to push forward. You know, we're talking about complex layers. You know, in the work that I did last year, I worked with Witness to produce a report called Cameras Everywhere, for example. And in the course of that report, we started out and we were writing a report that related, we thought, to how video can be protected with a view, how human rights video can be protected in an online environment. But during that, we had to grapple with interactions between human rights and technology in terms of human rights documentation, whistleblowing, WikiLeaks happened during this thing, copyright and intellectual property, trade talks, export controls, user-generated content and how that's handled in the newsroom, manufacture of hardware, how standards embedded within hardware and within your handset or within your laptop or within software, how you search and how you're permitted to search and what you're permitted to search for, the transfer of data between different jurisdictions and so on, all have an impact, not just on freedom of speech as a sort of core underpinning of human rights, but across a full range of human rights and the way in which people access and enjoy them. So tackling that kind of complexity means bringing together all these different groupings, and it's striking to me again how much collaboration is happening in other sectors, in open government and so on, but still in this sector there hasn't been a concerted effort where people are being drawn together on an equal basis from government and intergovernmental institutions, from civil society, from corporate entities, and from research and academia, you know, not to mention other sorts of settings. One of the problems underpinning this to me is that actually, and you know, maybe we'll get onto this in the discussion, is that legislative cycles and responses in terms of legislation and regulation tend to be quite long, unwieldy, consultations happen and so on that take a long time. Not everyone can participate in an equal footing. And this means that you're getting a sort of top layer response, which we've talked about a little bit already, that is very, very far removed from how quickly things move in the world that, for example, Bill moves in. And the companies that, you know, for example, Google, you know, they're 10 to 15 years old, where they're getting involved in issues of international law, in a sense. Yet they're sort of entities that are 10 to 15 years old, and they've grown from a garage to being sort of institutions almost in our in public debate. So there's a sort of there's a massive gap in terms of how people are able to understand these various layers, the sort of legislative layer, yet the layer on which these technologies evolve and change. And I think that's very true, again, of lawmakers and policymakers. What I think we have an opportunity to do is to set values in a way through these collaborative processes that are convenings, if you like, this sort of space that Marietje is trying to push forward very, very forcefully, I think, is to suffuse the discussions that all of us are having with the human rights values that that Mireille was talking about, that we need to push towards a point where the policies and the norms and the ethics do have an alignment. You know, there are processes happening, for example, in copyright policy, and the Washington Declaration on Intellectual Property, for example, tried to bring into, by bringing multiple people together, tried to bring a corporate, government, research interests together to develop an idea of the public interest in copyright policy, for example. But I think that that's still missing in this particular space. And I think that's partly through it's partly through spaces like this, the European Parliament, and the arenas around it, that these kinds of conversations need to be pushed forward and brought into to use the convening power of spaces like this to force those conversations into the fore. I think we can move.
Yes.
Yeah. Shall we move into discussion?
Okay, great. Thank you so much, because that really, you know, puts us in what we probably should be doing around here, trying to create a multidisciplinary discussion and really trying to dig deeper into this complex issue and understanding what relevant, appropriate, and also timely policies can be. Because I fully agree with what Samir said, a democratic decision-making process takes time. Technological developments happen at the speed of light. An inclusive process is important, preferably on an equal basis or equal footing, as you mentioned. But the reality is, of course, that on the one hand, the empowerment of individuals has allowed for very powerful voices by well-organized minorities to set the agenda. On the other hand, there is a difference in power between, for example, a couple of internet users in country A, B, or C, or a corporation like Google. I mean, it's clear that these are not equal voices or equal equal representations. So, yes, it is very complex, and I hope that this discussion will shed some light on the questions that we should be dealing with, and I'm very interested in hearing your questions. So please raise your hand, introduce yourself briefly, and then we can bring some initial questions to the panel. Do you want to go ahead first?
All right, is this on? Good morning. I'm Stefan Hanen from Europe Analytica, Public Affairs. So first of all, thank you for the presentation. It was quite insightful, and I think there were several questions raised, not just by the professor. So we've touched on the issue of net neutrality before, but I would just like to dive into that a bit more. So Mr. Ekkingson, you talked about the dangers of the upcoming ITU conference in December, where some governments would attempt to control the internet. But on the other hand, you know, I believe it was in 2009 that we saw the Freedom of the Internet Act proposed by Senator John McCain, which, you know, actually, considering the name, would actually do the opposite. It would prevent the FCC from guaranteeing net neutrality in the U.S. and, for that matter, in the entire world. So I'm guessing my question is, because we're balancing between, on the one hand, we need to have minimal regulation. On the other hand, some people have said before that it should be absolute. But to some extent, shouldn't there be the minimal regulation of guaranteeing net neutrality, and that we don't let corporations be the gatekeeper to this fantastic network. Thank you.
Okay, let me look around and see how many other questions there are to get a sense. This was a very technical question about sort of net neutrality, whether regulation is actually keeping the internet open or restricting it. And I'm sure Bill would like to say something about it. So why don't you go ahead and we'll gather some other questions.
You're going to gather questions?
No, go ahead.
I mean, briefly, we would believe in the multi-stakeholder system that's been built up. You look at the internet, it's been an incredible success. And it hasn't broken down as it's grown to serve 2 billion people and will probably double in the next year. I was just in Kenya, and you see, you know, a mobile banking system that's been built up that's the envy of the rest of the world, precisely because Kenya put in a positive regulatory environment. We're looking forward to the IGF in Baku because we believe that it should be governments, companies, and civil society together, that no one should have a block on the other or impose on the other, but we need to keep the present system, which is really working, to allow the internet to keep on growing. The internet isn't broken. The danger is that governments would crack down too much to break it.
All right, I'll take two more questions here. Yes, go ahead.
My name is Pierre Oosterlund. I'm a communications consultant working in this field. It was interesting to hear that both the American ambassador and you, Mr. Etchison, were trying to make the financial case for freedom of expression, saying that in countries where we have freedom of expression, things are moving better, we have more better economy, better lives, and whatever. All very fine, but I'd like to warn a little bit about just making the financial case.
Just to be fair to myself, it wasn't a financial case. It was one about development.
Yeah.
Because
okay.
It's that the internet can, a free and open internet can bring development rather than closing down the internet. So,
I'm sure it can, but there's also a general tendency to say we want freedom of expression because it's good for economy, it's good for development in general. I would say we want it because we believe in it. And we have to work on values here more than the financial argument. Take China and India. Where do we have the most free press? Where do we have the best or the highest development rates? Everybody knows that. I was working in Indonesia around 2001, where a lot of changes happened. I'm sure that since 2001, Indonesia has become a better country to live in. But in terms of financial and economic growth, it probably was more in the years before 2000. So just to say that we should not equal freedom with financial progress. We should do it because we believe in it, and the European Union should also say we work on this because we believe in it.
You know, I agree. I mean, it's first and foremost a human right, and it's something that is value-based. But it is also, I think, the other elements are important to bolster that argument.
Yes, please, Ambassador, go ahead.
It's a very tricky issue, but I want to answer that a yes and no. Yes, in the sense that look at Indonesia. During the Suharto era, our GDP grew from $75 billion in 1975. To $200 billion in 1998, a year before the economic crisis, the financial crisis. In 1999, our GDP slashed to $90 billion. Our economic growth was minus 13%. Our debt to GDP was 180%. This was in 1999. So today, our GDP is $1 trillion. We are the 16th largest economy in the world. Our debt to GDP is 23%. It's a dream here in Europe. We grow at 6.5%. We have 90 million middle class. And to a certain extent, I agree with Bill, it's with the freedom of expressions. In the old days, we only have one television. Now we have countless televisions, which bring new economy, which bring new businesses. We have internet explosions. We have a society that is much more mature democratically in terms of dealing with sensitive issues. But also, we have seen, as your example, the theory that an open economy equals to higher freedom of speech is not necessarily true. I'm not going to mention a particular name of a country, but in Asia, there's one country that is small and has a very high degree of economic development, but censors is done 24 hours a day. So it is yes and no, it's very tricky, but you know, it's something that I agree with Salim that this needs to have a larger debate in bringing all kind of people together. Thank you.
Let me do two things. Share a few thoughts from a policymaking perspective, and also try to come to some slightly more difficult questions for the panel. The reason why sometimes there's an attempt to connect the two issues is to try to use the tools that we have in terms of policymaking. For example, the moments when there's a trade agreement about to be negotiated, when a candidate member state seeks to join the European Union, or when aid treaties or agreements about development aid are made, to look at whether there is a way to tie economic support, economic benefits for a third country to what we call conditionality in the broadest sense in terms of human rights. And in that way, from a very pragmatic and sort of operational policy point of view, the two do get connected. And another reason is that some countries and also some individuals in a parliament like this think that human rights are a soft issue, that it's not very important, and that it's a world of statements that don't amount to much. Whereas some believe rather that, you know, when it comes to money and development, that it becomes more tangible and that that becomes a sort of a stronger incentive or a larger stick, if you want to look at it from that point of view. Now, on the incentives, in reality, of course, some companies have values that they would like to stick by. Sometimes a human rights angle and a business model are very much tied. In other cases, they aren't. And these are deliberations that are also made to try to either balance or choose business over human rights on a daily basis. And perhaps I can ask Bill to share a little bit of his thoughts on the one hand, being a global company that crosses and transcends or allows users to transcend borders on a daily basis. On the other hand, operating in different countries, like last week it was announced that Google struck a deal in Turkey, where us in the EU, we cannot share our concerns about free expression and internet freedom in Turkey enough. And in order for Google to operate in Turkey, there has to be an agreement to be to adhere as a company to local laws. And this is not only the case in Turkey, but in plenty of companies. And so here we see kind of a territory within a hyper-connected world emerging where companies that are, you know, incorporated in the United States, in the case of Google, do actually choose to comply with the law of the land for service in certain countries. And I think that brings us a little bit deeper, and of course there are economic trade-offs there, because otherwise a market may not be accessible in any case. But perhaps you can share a little bit about those deliberations. And then I've seen two questions over there, so I haven't forgotten you. We'll come back to you in a second.
So, I mean, I think to put the context, I think Professor explained how from the Yahoo case there was this localization issue, and when companies go in and localize, they obey local laws. So Google, when it is localized, does obey local laws. For example, in Germany, when we get requests from a court order in writing about Holocaust denial, we will take the material down on YouTube or on Blogger or on any of the platforms, and then report that to something called chillingeffects.org, which is run out of Harvard's Berkman Center, so that we're transparent about it, but we do comply with those legitimate court orders. In Turkey, you're right, Marietje, we did localize and set up a localized YouTube. We did this because we wanted to encourage local content in Turkey, and it does mean that we are subject to Turkish law, but we also feel that this would be a better way of trying to work to change the laws that you are talking about, which we also believe are too restrictive in Turkey, and which we've suffered by because YouTube was long banned in Turkey, for 2 years was banned. So, I mean, the idea was to encourage local creation and at the same time encourage a change in the internet laws by doing this.
We'll go to the next questions. The gentleman over there and then the gentleman over there.
Thanks. Israel Butler from Open Society, Brussels. We're speaking a lot about law and regulation, whether that's by the government or private, and it seems that our conversation is based on an assumption that it has to be a legal response, but is that the only tool available to us? It's also been highlighted that companies can switch jurisdiction, that the law is very slow in keeping pace, and court cases take a long time to enforce things. It strikes me that it's a bit like trying to shoot a frog using a tank. So I just wonder if there are other responses we might consider.
I'll just take two questions and then come back to the panel.
Hello, my name is Valentin Stanko. I am stagiaire here. It was said that our laws about Holocaust and discrimination, and it is not very good to prohibit these laws. And we can use debate in order to have a freedom of expression. But what can we do when we have hate, when we have discrimination, when we have racism? Can we solve the violence, or it is better to solve the source of violence? So I have this question for Mr. Bessems, because there are a lot of anti-Semitic conduct on Europe, racism conduct. What can we do? Because I think it is important to solve the source first, and not the violence. Can we condemn a people who is violent after being hard offended? Thank you.
Thank you very much for those two questions. I'll look around to the panel to see who wants to take on the question of trying to shoot a frog with a tank. Doesn't seem very effective in any case. So are laws the right tool, or are there more effective ways to deal with these challenges? And then the second question directly to Gustav Bessems about whether we need to deal with the source rather than or the source of violence rather than the violence itself, and what that would look like. Maybe I'll start with Gustav, if that's okay, and then Mireille? Yeah.
I could not agree with you more that we should first aim to eradicate the source of the violence. And there is only one source of the violence, and that is the perpetrator of the violence. The source of the violence is the person that raises his fist, that uses a knife, that shoots a gun. That is the source of the violence. No expression, however hurtful it might be to someone else, is ever a source of violence. Now, is there nothing we can do about discrimination, racism, anti-Semitism, you said? Well, at the moment, there is lots we can do about it. Most countries have vast possibilities legally to address those issues, too vast in my personal opinion. I think suppressing sentiments like that legally doesn't work. I don't think that will deal in the end with the core of these mechanisms of discrimination and exclusion and xenophobia. I think it's far more important to believe in the strength of your ideas, in the strength of the ideas of tolerance, of non-discrimination, of the fight against racism. And I think dealing with these things in a court might even be a handicap, because what it does is it sort of misplaces the problem. Oh, that'll be in court, they'll deal with that there. And I think, especially in a world where there is so much migration and so much interconnectedness, I think it's far more important to have these discussions very openly and very frankly rather than in a court. But I think the first point is the most important. I think saying that, for instance, in this case, someone who makes a film, however horrendous someone might find it, is the source of violence, I think it really is immoral and wrong.
Well, now we're getting into a really nice discussion, because it must be obvious that there I don't agree. I must say that I feel a bit uncomfortable, because I'm usually speaking in favor of free speech. I'm very much involved in data protection issues, so very much busy with the monitoring, which is one of the tools you have when you want to restrict free speech, and I'm very worried about the tool itself. But I would say rather the opposite. I would say that maybe it is very difficult to imagine for somebody who is, I'm going to be very blunt now, somebody who is white, who is educated, who has not been really unemployed, to imagine what it feels like to be on the other side, within a society or in a larger part of the world, and who's been feeling intimidated and discriminated on a lot of accounts. At the moment when somebody is in that position and somebody makes a film, and I'm not even that interested in the content of the film, but let's take the broader view on hate speech. I believe that that speech can be very intimidating, and that it is arrogant to say, look, you better learn to take this shit, because that's what is democracy. For me, the right to free speech is a precondition to democracy. That's where the value of the right of speech is, amongst others. Now, if the right of free speech functions in a way that actually excludes people, don't take them serious, then it doesn't function like that at all. And therefore, I still want to argue for the, to make a difference between offensive speech. I believe that thoroughly disagreeing, even saying very bad things to each other in a very argumentative way, that is democracy. I very much believe in that. But that's something entirely different from being denigrating. Saying things about people's religion, whereas that religion is a part of a person. We can determine for somebody else your religion is not a part of you, because in the 16th, 17th century we invented the separation of, etc., etc. We're not living in that century anymore. So if you insult a religion at some point in a certain way, you are telling somebody that he or she is not worth anything and doesn't understand how he or she should see things. That could mean that you're not taking serious that person. And I know that it's extremely difficult to make that difference in theory, but I think in practice it is easier. And it's very important to keep in mind why we have this right of free speech. If we want democracy, we have to put everybody in a position that everybody takes everybody serious and respects everybody.
Gustav would like to respond as well, and yeah. I think now we're finally going with the discussion, so I'll start to take down names, don't worry. Gustav, then you, and then I'll take a few new ones here.
Well, two brief points. First of all, I think it would be wonderful if we could have the discussion based mainly on arguments and not on what we think or might think others can imagine or can't imagine, or what life experiences they've had or have not had when it comes, for instance, to unemployment or being discriminated. I mean, I don't have knowledge of those experiences of the other people in this room, and I think most of us don't have that about each other. The second point is taking people seriously. What you say when you say, I can't say anything insulting about their religion, I can't mock that prophet, because otherwise those people are going to be so insulted and so angered and so enraged, that is not taking people seriously. That is pretending like you're dealing with savages, with barbarians, that don't have the self-restraint to respond in a normal manner to expressions like those. The reality is, the vast majority of people has that kind of self-restraint, engages in normal ways. We shouldn't pretend, even though the images are there, for instance, that Muslims, in the response to this film, like there was an enormous mass of people using violence. That wasn't the case. There were small numbers, it was often organized, and we shouldn't let them determine the image, for instance, of Muslims in the world and the response we expect from people when a horrible film is made. So I think that is taking people seriously.
On another note, the context of democracy that came up is a fascinating one, because we you know, when I travel to a country like Egypt or other places where there's a transition and where there's a search for new freedoms as well as laws guaranteeing them, part of the result that we saw in response to the film Innocence of Muslims specifically can also be seen in the context of people unfamiliar with a country where diverse voices can arise, where it is unthinkable that someone can make a movie without government consent, and perhaps therefore violence directed at representations of the government instead of others. On the other hand, I also wonder whether extremists who are eager to use violence ever need an excuse or a reason that we need to try to validate. I've seen a lot of hands, so I want to take three questions from the audience and then come back. The first one here in the front, then the lady over there. If everyone could just raise their hands well, because it's hard for me to see. Okay, so we'll do one, two, three, and then come back to you and you. Thank you.
Thanks. My name is James Waterworth. I work for the Computer and Communications Industry Association, the CCIA. My question is to the Indonesian ambassador. When you were making your introductory comments, you, I think, alluded to the difficulty of including questions such as freedom of speech in trade agreements. And one of the things which I find very interesting, and our companies find very interesting, is that as more and more of the economy becomes dematerialized and you move away from other bits of the ICT sector or whatever sector to the online economy, the internet economy, many aspects of this will probably want or need to be translated into some way, shape or form into trade agreements, be they multilateral or bilateral free trade agreements. And I fully recognize the problematic nature of including many of these questions within these agreements. And we saw in Europe earlier this year the fiery nature of the debate, for example, around ACTA, which raised many questions about fundamental freedoms and the internet. Given these problems, I wonder if you have any thoughts about baby steps that companies and governments should be taking to begin progress in this direction, which must surely be made over the coming decade.
Thank you. We'll take
it. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, my name is Fazia. I'm from Pakistan Embassy. There is nothing official about whatever I am saying. It is just purely an academic question. Like, I agree that when some of the panelists, they said that technological advancements, they are, you know, they are being made at lightning pace, and we have not been able to keep, you know, our pace with that. My concern is, being a mother, you know, the very basic things or the minimum regulations on the internet, yes, I will definitely ask for that. Because if I watch a TV or my son is watching the TV, there is always written that this is not suitable for children under 12, this is not suitable for children under 5. And I will definitely give you an example from Peshawar. There was a kid, a teenager, who was brilliant and who was taking very good positions, and now he's in mental hospital because he watched something on the internet, and that was beheading of 25 soldiers of Pakistan Army who got beheaded by the Taliban. When he watched that, there was, you know, the mother said that there was nothing on the YouTube which could alert even her that what his, you know, her child is going to watch. And now that child is in mental hospital, running it, you know, running traumatized at nights because he feels that someone is cutting his limbs as well. And about this movie, like the innocence of Muslims, obviously, you're very right that, you know, we were born and we are raised that way, that religion is, you know, our part. I have to respect, you know, my prophet. That is in me. And definitely, you know, I'm not going to, you know, use violence or anything, but yes, I would definitely like to register that I did get hurt. I am not going to respect that, disrespect my prophet because someone has made a third-rate movie on that. But the thing is, something has to be, because when I watched the movie, I would have liked that there should be something that this is going to hurt the sentiments of few people or, you know, one religious group. And this is the minimum which we should introduce. We are talking about big things like freedom of speech and freedom of this or freedom of that, just the basic minimum regulation, which should just notify me that this may hurt you or this may not be suitable for your child.
Thank you. Yes, lady in the back.
Annie Deal, I'm a stagiaire here at the Parliament. And I just had a question for our academic panelist. In addressing the issue of offensive versus hate speech, you said that in theory it's difficult to make a difference, but in practice it's easier. And I just wanted to see if you had any suggestions for how that would actually look in a society. Thank you.
Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead. Oh. No, that's great. Go okay. ahead.
First, I want to say something because what I said about the arrogance of white, very well-off people was certainly not meant personal in any sense. I should have said us, people who are feeling, or maybe feeling is not the right word, but who are in a different sort of position. That actually relates to the question you ask. If you begin to make all sorts of theoretical differences between free speech, offensive speech, and hate speech, then you can make a very nice rules and deductions, and you can say under these conditions it's this, and under those conditions it's that. But of course, if you look at it from the perspective of law and from the perspective of courts, which have been dealing with these sort of questions for a long time, you have to take into account a million of circumstances. And in this particular case, the question whether something is hate speech in the sense of intimidating and not taking people serious, not in a theoretical sense, but of trying to violate their dignity, saying you don't count as one of us. Courts have developed very interesting and practical balances between the objective and the subjective. Because, of course, it is true that courts are not going to be engaged with what people happen to feel. That's not the issue. So you make, considering all the circumstances, you make a judgment whether what was said should semi-objectively be seen as something that is trying to put people down and that can be reasonably understood as such. And my worry is that we end up with a kind of very impracticable but also morally very problematic free speech fundamentalism. Like, as long as it's speech and as long as you don't use a knife, it should be okay. I think that is too easy. And the question, when is speech offensive and when is it denigrating, is of course a very hard one. But if we don't want to face that, we end up in an absolutism, which is not going to solve any problems. It makes it easier on us because we can say, well, no, we like this rational debate, but it's not going to make it easier in the world.
No, just two pieces of context, as far as I understand, it may help the discussion. One, from experience, we know that people looking at content online have a very different perception of what is legal and illegal than judges, for example. So things like hotlines collect a lot of notifications of content that would legally not stand as illegal, but could be undesired, at least as identified by those individuals. And as far as I'm concerned, the European Court of Human Rights doesn't rule about whether people are offended, and rightfully so or not, but rather rules in the conflict or the hierarchy between fundamental rights. So, for example, whether free speech or freedom of religion or freedom of assembly, for example, prevail over another. But this is just for context. I just wanted to give Bill the floor now to talk about
Well, there were two issues. There were two issues and two points, I think, brought up. One was the responsibility. And offline, the responsibility, we have rules. We have libel rules, and we have defamation rules. The person who says or acts is responsible for what they said or acts. And one of the problems we're facing at Google is that it's often the platform, us, that are come for the material that's brought up onto that platform. So in Brazil, there's about the election speech. There was a video put up on YouTube, and our president gets arrested. The same thing in Italy. There's a video that went up, and people, our top executives, were convicted of allowing that video to get up, even though they had nothing to do with it. They didn't produce it. They didn't even know about it. And they took it down once they were informed about it. So I think this is very important that we don't shoot the postman, for us, for delivering a letter that you don't like, and that you get the person who wrote the letter. If that broke the law, that's important. Now, these are often difficult choices, because you talked about what offends and so forth, and what is legitimate and what isn't legitimate. Let me give you some concrete examples with things that we've dealt with at YouTube that give you an idea. Should we have taken down the videos of the violence from Tunisia or Syria? Or are they newsworthy? They were often graphic, disturbing, but in the end, we thought they were newsworthy, and that you know, the internet provided a glimpse onto what was happening in Syria, that when there was a massacre by the father, Assad's father, 20 years ago, were unavailable. And even the last example I'll give is of a video of an teenage girl giving birth to a stillborn baby. It's graphic, it's disturbing, and we were ready to take it down until we learned that it was an advertisement by the UK Ministry of Health against unwanted teenage pregnancy. So often these choices are just very, very difficult, and we would prefer to err on the side of leaving the maximum up.
Very quickly, to follow on from what Bill's saying, I was involved about 5 years ago in setting up and running a civil society-driven video website, which was set up really in opposition almost, or as a sort of alternative human rights approach to dealing with online video. At the time, YouTube was in its infancy, and they really did not, these were not questions that YouTube had to grapple with. You know, people were talking to them about, you know, why was this video taken down? Why was that video taken down? There really were no sort of broader guidelines. That online video was still reasonably marginal. And so these kinds of questions have shifted hugely over the last three, four years. And, you know, you're right that 5 years ago, protest videos were taken down. Korean protest videos were sort of requested to be taken down. Evidence of torture was taken down, and sometimes it was classic when it was put up in order to mask it. It was classed as comedy. You know, people had to resort to all kinds of different strategies because this was an unfamiliar form of speech. So there is a very, very big shift in how these things have happened. But again, setting down very, very schematic sort of taxonomies of what is and what is not permitted is also quite difficult, you know, in an online sphere, because these norms shift. And as you say, things are, speech is dynamic, and speech responds to previous speech. And, you know, speech on top of speech is dynamic. It creates new norms, new scenarios. So to try and delimit what is and is not permitted in a very strict way, it's not in sort of international standards, and I think even in a sort of terms of service level, for example, you try and keep quite broad definitions. So I think that, that these are shifting and people are becoming a little bit more precise about what is and isn't permitted, but pinning it down exactly is always going to be a dynamic question.
Ambassador, please, on the trade question.
Yeah, thank you. Not all of the trade issue today is modern. You know, we have still 212 tariffs on agricultural product in Europe, which needs to be dismantled, which I think is still a very sensitive political issue here in Europe. And in this situation, in the fact that we still have the tariff barriers on agricultural products or any other product in many different countries, to then come up and link access of internet, ICT, with trade barriers, then you will you risk of bringing new other different issues in different parts of the discussion and debate. I think we have already included in the FTA issues like services, issue like infrastructures, internet economy as part of the trade negotiations, bilateral trade negotiations. But I think we still need to see a lot of work to be done on which part of the ICT that you know, can or cannot be linked to trade barriers or protective measures. The world economy is not doing pretty well, and if you start to bring the subjective matter into world economy, world trade, it will actually probably reduce even further the growth of the world. So my concern is that. Thank you.
Okay, I'll give Gustav an opportunity to answer to some of the questions. I'll look around the room for a final round of questions, then I'll give the floor to each panelist for both answers and final thoughts, because we're... Yeah, okay. Okay, so we'll go back to the room. Please, anyone who has a question left, this is your opportunity. Yes, gentleman here.
Yes, my name is Jean-Paul Marteaus. I'm the advisor here in Brussels for CBJ, the Committee to Protect Journalists. I have two short questions. First one to the ambassador in Indonesia. In the last year, there has been a campaign in the UN system sponsored by the organization of the Islamic Conference for a resolution banning the defamation of religion, in particular Islam. It was defeated to some extent. It faded away a few months ago. And then after the innocence of Muslims, fury, I mean, it's back on the agenda. Is Indonesia in favor of that resolution that might be adopted by the UN? Is there more chances that it might be adopted in that current context? And then I have a second quick question on the question of the ITU conference in Dubai. You mentioned that there would be risk involved in that conference. Could you just give us a bit more information about what are the risks that might be involved to the extent that the ITU is run by consensus? And I suppose that a couple of European countries and the US would certainly oppose the resolution that you, that we might find offensive and an attack against free speech. And is there an EU decision to draft a common position for all the national delegations going to the ITU conference? And by the way, I might have missed something, but no one mentioned the Internet Governed Forum, which would take place in Baku in a month. Is it just a useless or peripheral exercise?
At the risk of, posing a question that is that might be sounding weird in a debate on free speech in a hyper-connected world, but isn't there the chance that we might be overstating the importance of the hyper-connectedness, the importance of the internet, since, as Mr. Atkinson just said, Google, but basically the internet itself, is merely the medium and not the message itself. So how much is actually new, because as we're seeing provisions on human rights in trade agreements, that's been there for a long time already. Sure, movies are disseminated more easily. But how fundamentally different is this actually?
The professor asked, underlined the question of being when a discourse can be shocking, but I would also ask, where is it shocking? And I would ask the journalist, is it the same to have something on the YouTube that you can, I would say, stop to watch, or for a Muslim to walk on the street and having, for like Charlie Hebdo did in France, having on the first page this drawing that can be really shocking? And to me, it's really different to have something on the movie on YouTube that you could stop just by clicking, and walking on the street and having all the time the same stories shocking you, and you haven't asked for that.
Thank you. Thank you. My name's Neil McDonald. I'm a stagiaire for Baroness Ludford MEP. Mine is more a sort of moralistic question from a human rights perspective. Firstly, as regards the protection of offensive speech in the Council of Europe area, I'm aware of the case of Otto Preminger against Austria, which concerned the Little Red Book, published in South Tyrol, a region with a population of over 80% of devout Catholics, and it portrayed Virgin Mary as a prostitute and various other deeply sacrilegious things, which were nonetheless considered to benefit from the protection of freedom of expression under the Convention of 1957, so I can contribute that. But to get to my question, really, I suppose it's really for Mr. Basims. How can you really separate the question of how can you separate offensive expression from the root intolerance? I mean, is there not a sort of a chicken and egg situation here? Thank you.
Sorry, I need you to repeat it. I'll answer it later, but I didn't get it.
My question is it not possible to address the overall problem of root intolerance by, to a degree, suppressing offensive or hateful expression? In the back of my mind, I'm thinking of, I've attended football matches where I've seen 4 or 5 year old children singing deeply offensive, hateful songs, and it occurs to me, where did they learn that if not from offensive expressions such as songs? And I suspect you're going to reassert the sort of Thomas Jefferson principle: those who sacrifice liberty for security deserve neither and will get both. But yeah, but I just wanted to see, does that never trouble you that it would, it seems to be a chicken and egg situation?
Thank you so much for all of these questions. Is it okay to start with you, Professor Hildebrand, and then we go down the panel like this, and I'll say a few words in the very end.
Oops. I want to turn the discussion around a bit, because I think I've made quite clear that, as a kind of closing statement, I've made quite clear that I think that for me, free speech is a precondition for a democratic constituency. At the world level, we don't have that. But that means I am, in principle, a very fierce defender of free speech. And I do think there are some exceptions, and that is not offensive speech, but hate speech. And I want to just briefly mention that I think that sometimes the means to achieve the protection against hate speech are worse than the objective than you want to achieve. And I'm very worried about all the technologies that are being used, for instance, to check the internet for spam, for security reasons, viruses, for infringements of copyright, for seeking out pornography, notice and take down. Of course, there's a lot of automated software that does this for us. Deep packet inspection. So to the extent that my argument that we must protect against hate speech would be taken to be in favor of using more these kind of technologies, I would back out from that, because I think that these technologies have a far-reaching effect on other human rights, like privacy, that are also preconditions for a democracy. So I just want to make clear where my position is, that it doesn't linger that I think that the ultimate issue is the issue of hate speech. I would want to have that as a extreme situation. I'm not talking about offensive speech.
Yes, we support that, but in the context of our being party to the conventions on the civil and political rights, and also our new laws on the free speech and also on the blasphemy, which we have already put them in line with the international laws that we ratified. I think also in closing, I believe what Bill mentioned about localizing the content into bringing it into in line with the local laws would be something that you know is worth considering, because if the standard is the convention, the ICCPR, which is international standard, and is ratified and brought on at the national level, so if a court decision or decision by the government in line with that convention on a particular content, I think it should be fine. Because if we are looking at the world regulations, I'm not so sure whether it's possible. I want to come back with my initial story. We have a sort of same analogy. We have films coming from the U.S. Spread out all over the world, and a request to remove that is impossible or difficult. The same with our case. We have $750 million being wired from Indonesia to Europe. When we try to get the money back, they say, well, you know, there are legal technicalities, there is this issue, that issue. So it's a tricky issue. And even you have a convention on asset recovery or returning of the stolen asset, we face that in the UK, we face that in the Netherlands, we face that in Switzerland. So I don't know. When it's billions of dollars, I think there's a different story than here.
Yes, there was the question, is it different, for instance, when something's on YouTube, you can simply not watch it, or something's on the cover of Charlie Hebdo, and it's in a kiosk in the street? Yes, that's different. When you walk down the street and you see the Charlie Hebdo in the kiosk, you will have to, for instance, turn away your head, not watch it, not buy the magazine. Maybe if you see it the third time, you might be really annoyed. Maybe you'll be provoked to write a letter to the magazine. Maybe you want to start your own magazine against Charlie Hebdo. So that is more of a nuisance, and I think living in an open and free democratic society very often is a nuisance to all of us. Can laws help suppress intolerance? Sometimes they can. The example you gave, I think, is an excellent example where it can't. You talked about children singing hateful songs at football matches. Would you propose that we arrest the children, that we persecute the children, that we bring them in front of a court? Would you suggest that we do that to their parents? Or is this purely a case of education, for instance, which I think would be a far better option? A response to Professor Hildebrand. I'm still not really getting the us whites and the rest of the world thing exactly. Maybe I'm completely naive and idealist and utopian, but I truly believe in global citizenship and looking at people as individuals, no matter the color of their skin or their religion or their gender. I think it's about their personalities and their talents, and I think universal human rights are called universal for a reason, and I don't think there's any category of people, for instance, who's not up to the freest possible speech. Another thing, I would like to see the faces of judges when they're being told that determining hate speech in practice isn't all that difficult. If you just look at the criteria that were mentioned here, not taking people seriously or violating their dignity, I think those are really, really hard concepts in practice. And I think we can see that in court cases. For instance, in my country, in the Netherlands, years ago, a politician was convicted for saying we should abolish multicultural society and the country's full.
years later, that more or less became a mainstream political viewpoint to have, and we could have had half the parliament convicted for exactly those statements. Another politician, Geert Wilders, anti-Islam, anti-immigration, was cleared from charges, even though his statements went much, much further than this. So how is this easy? And there was the question, do we overestimate the aspect of being hyper-connected? I don't think we are, and I don't think we can. The fact that in Denmark, a cartoonist still lives behind, you know, heavier doors in his house under full protection, still gets attacked for a cartoon that he drew years and years ago, has everything to do with that hyper-connectedness, the fact that people in other parts of the world still have direct access to that, or sometimes rumor and gossip about that, because that is also a part of that hyper-connectedness. So I really think the conversation about this topic truly is global for that reason, and maybe to leave with a final thought, to insert in that conversation, I would like to address the whole thing of religious insult, being insulted because someone says something about your religion. And I would like to leave you with the question, to what extent is being insulted because someone says something about your religion or your prophet a decision that you make? You might believe that your religion is wonderful and that your prophet is an example in your life. And someone else might think that your religion is backward and the prophet is an example of everything, how you should not lead your life. How does that take something away from you? Why does that make your religion anything less? Why does that make your prophet anything less? And why can you not decide not to be insulted by that? Thank you.
Thank you. I think I wanted to conclude, talk about what is the power of the internet and what is new in it in letting all of us express ourselves. I was a journalist in the 1980s covering Poland, and I saw in Poland that 20 million people joined, or 10 million, sorry, joined Solidarity within weeks of the ability to have a free trade union, and there was no internet. So it's not the internet that necessarily leads to social movements and so forth, but the internet, what it has done, is allowed all of us to express ourselves for the first time more freely. To give a figure, 72 hours of video is going up every minute on YouTube. And that is double, when, I think, 2 years ago. So there is this explosion of everyone being able to publish their thoughts, express themselves, and to be able to see it from around the world, anywhere. And that is a revolutionary tool. In the sort, but the issues we're talking about are often old ones, just amplified by the internet.
Okay, three quick points. One on the issue of hate speech, there is a real groundswell of response. To think through these issues, try to come up with new responses, particularly to non-legal approaches. The UN Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Opinion and Expression, Frank LaRue, has been working on this and is due to issue a report imminently. I think it's in two and a half weeks in New York to the UN. So I'd encourage you all to look at that process. That's in a sense a beginning of the conversation and sort of opening up in all these different arenas what kinds of approaches people might take and what approaches people are taking, and also how does this relate to a human rights framework. And that's in a context in which lots and lots of countries, the UK, the Director for Public Prosecutions issued a statement saying that he's going to hold a public consultation around how, for example, speech in online media are dealt with on the back of numerous cases that have happened that have, you know, have gone to court and then been overturned and so on, related to individual tweets and so on. And also, you know, the Council of Europe is working on this, INAC, which is a Berlin-based, I think, organization around cyber hate and so on. So there are lots and lots and lots of pushes on this to try and look at non-legal approaches, try and develop literacy across a much broader swathe of people. So that's something I'd encourage people to look at. also working with judiciaries, you've mentioned the law and so on, working with judiciaries and with lawyers to help them accelerate their own understanding on these issues. One of the things around the video I think that was interesting is something that nobody's, I mean, you came closest to it, Marietje, was talking about the political context inside a country, not just, I think, to talk about a global context in which every citizen is equal and how they participate, I think is unrealistic. There are local political realities, as you sort of outlined, into which these things happen, which also contribute to the debate and how these issues get globalized. And two very quick last issues. In that context, because there's a lack of research underpinning the policy processes, there isn't enough research and there isn't enough research that brings together these domains. So that's another area that I think for policymakers there is a problem and a capacity gap to understand how these issues connect. That also affects particularly southern, less developed kind of other countries outside the European frame, but it's also a problem here. And in the context of Open Society, we commissioned a huge series of reports which try and pull some of these issues out about digitization, how it affects freedom of expression and so on, called Mapping Digital Media. And you can see that in many countries, this is the first time anyone has pulled together empirical research on the relationship between the internet, media, and democracy. So that's a huge area that really policymakers need to rely on civil society and companies as well, research that's produced by a variety of stakeholders to strengthen the policymaking process. And then lastly, looking at software, talking about how what Mireille was saying and how technology empowers and so on. The other area is that actually sort of software can be used by governments to control the flow of information. And there's a human rights value embedded within the software itself, also in the software and services produced by companies. And I think that that's something that needs more interrogation on a political level. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm afraid the local reality here is that we need to evacuate this room as soon as possible. But I just wanted to say a few final words and then ask you to help us clear the room for the next people. Thank you so much for your active participation, critical questions and comments, and openness in addressing this difficult issue, of which we haven't concluded anything that we can now close this chapter. This is indeed a very new reality that we're living in, a hyper-connected world and how it relates to human rights such as freedom of expression. It challenges the fundamental responsibilities of governments, of protecting the rights of their citizens as these citizens begin to operate online across borders on a daily basis, and therefore are on the one hand empowered. They can themselves access information, share information, freely speak, and assemble online. On the other hand, the power gets redistributed to companies as well, and this in turn challenges the question of final responsibility for safeguarding people's fundamental rights, but also other issues like security. And this issue of territoriality and how the nation state's law relate to the hyperconnectivity and borderless world online is most seriously seen in countries like Iran, where there are attempts to completely close off the population from the World Wide Web, but the impact of decisions such as the ones by Google to abide by local laws also in a way refragments this sort of open internet along different layers. And for us, policymakers that are bound by the slow speed of democratic decision-making in relation to the rapid technological developments, we need to clearly understand what our role is, how we can work together with businesses, with civil society, with internet users and consumers and human rights organizations and governments to really understand how we can protect people's universal human rights, and we should always critically assess who needs to be protected against whom. I think that was still not entirely clear in some of the discussions here. It's not only about protecting people from each other, but also from governments, for example, and from new monopolies that are formed in the form of companies. So let us indeed continue to exchange experiences and knowledge, including about technology, which is indeed often lacking and very important. So I invite you all to continue this discussion, and I'm sure this won't be the last one. So thanks to the panel for their time, and thank you for your participation.